BGMC. The biblical truth lives here.
Scriptures foretold of the Anointed One, Yeshua HaMashiach. The Messiah Yeshua came to call the people back to the truth of His Word and to follow that righteous path. Yeshua then called Jewish men to be His disciples, and after His death and resurrection, those Jewish men told the world about the Jewish Messiah. Now, after 2,000 years, Beth Goyim Messianic Congregation has that same calling of those Jewish men, telling all people, both Jew and Gentile, about the proper ancient path, teaching the Route 66 King's Highway from Genesis through to Revelation, and how you need and can get back to the proper roots of the faith and a closer walk with God. Now, let's hear the message.
Let's go get a blessing. Turn to the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5. The Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5, verse 48, we're going to start out with. Gospel of Matthew, chapter 5. This is message P248. P248 is called Mattiyahu 5. Mattiyahu 5. We're going to look at chapter 5, and we're going to discern some things that what we need to be doing and what's important to the Lord and what Messiah was talking about. And the synopsis of what we're doing, we're living in troubled times. It is a fruit of moving the boundary stone. It is a fruit of increased distance from the perfect law of our God. Black lives do not matter. White lives do not matter. Yellow lives do not matter. Latino lives do not matter. Filipino lives do not matter. What does matter is how each person lives their life in relation to the one life that does matter, and that is Yeshua the Messiah. Our foundation scripture is Matthew 5, verse 48. Matthew 5, verse 48. Therefore, be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Then our theme for this Ever Shabbat message, P248, is once the marker is moved, all the morals are moved. Devarim 19:14. Well, we're not going to go to that. Let's go to Matthew. We're going to Matthew 5. Matthew 5 is what we're going to be doing. Matthew 5, we're going to read the whole chapter, and then we're going to break it down, chapter, so you can understand verse 48. Part 1 is the bees. Verse 1 through 12, the teaching Yeshua gave to them starts out with what some people call the Beatitudes. Part 2, verse 13 through 16, the light. Part 3, verse 17 through 19, the perfect 100%. Part 4, verse 20 through 32, points of the law. Part number 5, verse 33 to 37, vows are simple. Part number 6 is 38 to 44, becoming the servant. And part number 7, finally, is verse 45 to 48. Now that you know all that, be perfect, at least try to. Amen? All right, let's take a look at Matthew 4, chapter 5, verse 48. Let's start with the last verse of the chapter that we're going to read. Mattiyahu 5, verse 48. Therefore, be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Amen? This should be the goal of all people. This should be the goal of all people, to try to be perfect, okay? Just as our Father in heaven is perfect, your goal is that. If you fall short of perfection and getting the 100 on the test, I think that's okay. But the thing that the Father wants us to try to do, because His life is really the only one that matters, we need to try to appease the Father in heaven. The goal should be, with all due diligence, to reach the goal of being perfect. I don't think anybody's ever going to do it, because only Yeshua the Messiah is perfect. But it doesn't mean that you don't try. It doesn't mean that you don't give your best effort. But, you know, a lot of what is taught in Messianic congregations, and, you know, certainly in Christendom, New Testament congregations, No, oh, we can't do that. Why shouldn't we? If Yeshua is saying, therefore be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect, why is it that we shouldn't shoot for perfection? Why isn't it that we shouldn't try for perfection? Since he is our example, we should try for perfection. Because if you call yourself a Christian, well, what does that word mean? Christ-like, Messiah-like, okay? That is what this message, this teaching for this Erev Shabbat is all about. It is about trying for that perfection. It is wanting to get 100 on a test. Okay, you know, most people don't go, yes, I'd like to get a 60 on a test. Okay, in America, when I was a kid, you know, 100 was perfect. 100 to 90 was an A. 89 to 80 was a B. 79 to 70 was a C. And 69 to 61 was passing. Anything below a 61 was a failure. Okay, was a failure. So do we shoot for, you know, just getting a D? Do we shoot for just getting a C? You know, does the guy get up, you know, playing Major League Baseball? Does he get up, maybe I want to try to get a hit tonight. Okay, maybe I want to try to hit the ball. Of course, every single time the person gets up to bat, they want to hit the ball and they want to get on base or hit the ball out of the park. Now, looking at Matthew 5, verse 48 again, therefore, be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. The sentence spoken by Messiah is a truly amazing sentence. Why do I say it's amazing? What Yeshua is saying in these few words is that all the mitzvot given to us by Avinu, our Father, are perfect. Let me say that again. Okay? In light of verse 48, therefore be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect, what is Yeshua saying? Yeshua is saying in these few words that all the mitzvot that Yehovah, Avinu, our Father, gave us, they are perfect. And we should strive to try to do them. Not to try to do the least of them, but to do all of them. Okay? All people should try to do them. For the Father would not give us, his people, anything that was not perfect. Okay? So he said, you know, kosher, don't eat the pig. Eat the animal that has a split hoof and choose the cud. He says these things, you know, you may not even understand the reasons, and nor do you have to. He told us these things because he's perfect, and he wants us to try to be perfect, and Father knows best. His values are perfect. That's one of the things that we should understand, that he gave us these rules so that our morals, our values, should be perfect, okay? Because we reflect his kingdom, okay? So he gave us these perfect mitzvot so that we, his children, should reflect the values of Avinu, our Father. His ways are perfect. His ways of doing things are perfect. You know, as we entered into the fourth month, we should have sounded the shofar. We should have called the Rosh Kodesh, okay? We should have sang songs, okay? Why? Because God wants us, he wants us to remind us of following the cycle of the moon so that we know when the holy days are, okay? If we, his people, would grasp this simple concept that his laws are perfect from generation to generation and they do not change, if we would understand this concept, then all things now and forever would be good. That's one of the things that we should really truly understand, that if we follow this perfection, that his values are perfect, his morals are perfect, his ways of doing things are perfect, and we are not one to question him. Now, with this foundation scripture in mind for today's lesson, let us understand how we have arrived at this part in history. Let's take a look at the rest of Matthew 5, okay? Let's take a look at what Yeshua is trying to tell us in this teaching. Because it's broken down, we're going to read the whole chapter, so it's a little long, but try to stay, you know, with me, okay? Now we're going to break it down and understand why we are to try to be perfect, because we reflect him. But there's going to be stages that we're to understand, okay? Matthew 5, Mattiyahu 5, let me get a glass of water here. We're going to do verse 1 through 48. We're going to do the whole chapter. Matthew 5, Mattiyahu 5, verse 1 through 48. Seeing the crowds, Yeshua walked up the hill. After he sat down, his Talmudim came to him, and he began to speak. This is what he taught them. How blessed are the poor in spirit, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. How blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. How blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the land. How blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. How blessed are those who show mercy, for they will be shown mercy. How blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. How blessed are those who make peace, for they will be called sons of Elohim. How blessed are those who are persecuted because they pursue righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. How blessed you are when people insult you and persecute you and tell all kinds of vicious lies about you because you follow me. Rejoice, be glad, because your reward in heaven is great. They persecuted the prophets before you in the same way. You are the salt for the land, but if the salt becomes tasteless, how can it be made salty again? It is no longer good for anything except being thrown out for people to trample on. You are the light for the world. A town built on a hill cannot be hidden. Likewise, when people light a lamp, they don't cover it with a bowl, but put it on a lampstand so that it shines for everyone in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before people so that they may see the good things you do and praise your Father in heaven. Don't think that I've come to abolish the Torah or the prophets. I've come not to abolish, but to complete. Yes, indeed, I tell you that until heaven and earth pass away, not so much as a yod or a stroke will pass from the Torah, not until everything that must happen has happened. So whoever disobeys the least of these mitzvot and teaches others to do so will be called the least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever obeys them and so teaches will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you that unless your righteousness is far greater than that of the Torah teachers and the Pirushim, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of heaven. You have heard that our fathers were told, do not murder, and that anyone who commits murder will be subject to judgment. But I tell you that anyone who nurses anger against his brother will be subject to judgment. That whoever calls his brother, you good for nothing, will be brought before the Sanhedrin. That whoever says fool incurs the penalty of bringing in the fire Gehinnom. So if you are offering the gift at the temple altar and you remember that that your brother has something against you, leave your gift where it is by the altar and go make peace with your brother. Then come back and offer your gift. If someone sues you, come to terms with him quickly while you and he are on the way to court. Or he may hand you over to the judge and the judge to the officer of the court and you may be thrown in jail. Yes, indeed, I tell you, you will certainly not get out until you have paid the last penny. You have heard that our fathers were told, do not commit adultery. But I tell you that a man even looks at a woman with the purpose of lusting after her has already committed adultery with her in his heart. If your right eye makes you sin, gouge it out and throw it away. Better that you should lose one part of you than have your whole body thrown in Gehinnom. And if your right hand makes you sin, cut it off and throw it away. Better that you should lose one part of you than have your whole body thrown in Gehinnom. It was said, whoever divorces his wife and gives her a get, but I tell you that anyone who divorces his wife, except on the grounds of fornication, makes her an adulteress. And that anyone who marries a divorcee commits adultery. Again, you have heard that our fathers were told, do not break your oath and keep your vows to Jehovah. But I tell you not to swear at all. Not by heaven, because it is God's throne. Not by earth, because it is his footstool. And not by Jerusalem, because it is the city of the great king. And do not swear by your head, because you can't make a single hair white or black. Just let your yes be yes, and your no be simple no. Anything more than that has its origins in evil. You've heard that our fathers were told eye for eye and tooth for tooth. But I tell you not to stand up against someone who does you wrong. On the contrary, if someone hits you on the right cheek, let him hit you on the left cheek too. If someone wants to sue you for your shirt, let him have your coat as well. And if a soldier forces you to carry his pack 1 mile, carry it too. When someone asks you for something, give it to him. When someone wants to borrow something from you, lend it to him. You have heard that our fathers were told, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies, pray for those who persecute you. Then you will become children of your Father in heaven. For he makes the sun shine on the good and the bad people alike. He sends rain to the righteous and the unrighteous alike. What reward do you get if you love only those who love you? Why? Even the tax collectors do that. And if you are friendly only to your friends, are you doing anything out of the ordinary? Even the goyim do that. Therefore, be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Amen? Pretty long passage, but we're going to break down certain aspects for this Erev Shabbat teaching. Let us look at verse 48. Once again, let's look at verse 48 once again. Therefore, be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Amen? We began this teaching today with these words. When we look at the boundary stone, there's a part in the Torah, in Devarim 19, that we talk about the boundary stone. Don't move your neighbor's boundary stone. And when we move the boundary stone, we move the laws of God. And when we move the laws of God, the farther we get from where that boundary stone has been moved from, the worse the society gets that has moved the boundary stone. Let me say that again. When we move the boundary stone, if we say that we don't have to follow these perfect laws anymore, as the Christian church teaches and many Messianic congregations teach, unfortunately, if Yeshua is saying, be perfect, just as your Father in heaven is perfect, if we move that boundary stone to say, we can't do the law anymore, we can't follow Yeshua anymore, we can't do those offerings anymore, then we have moved the boundary stone. And once you move the boundary stone, you're the first person to move it, then your children move it a little further, then their children move it a little further, and pretty soon there is a chasm between you and where the boundary stone should have been. So Yeshua is saying that we should strive for perfection just as our Father in heaven is perfect. Now I'm sure those listening to this message and the time of this, we're recording it live now, but I'm sure if somebody's watching it later on, you may not know what occurred. In America today, or last night, there was a horrendous thing. There was a shooting between a police officer and another person, a white police officer and a black gentleman. There's no white or black. There's just different shades of melanin, okay? The person that has darker skin color than me has just more melanin in his skin. There really are no races at all. If you look under a microscope, there is no difference between one person to the next. There really are no races. But in America, there was a shooting in Louisiana. But last night in Dallas, Texas, a black man, a person of African-American descent, decided to assassinate police officers. And that wasn't the only one. There was another one in Georgia. There was another one in St. Louis. I forgot where the third one was last night. See, what happened is when we move the boundary stone, when we do not think of God's teaching as perfect, and when we do not fear God, then these things are rapidly approaching us. Anarchy is beginning to set in, not just here in America, but throughout the globe. Now, we read 48 verses. In Matthew 5, I want to show you something. In this teaching, I'm going to show you something on why we're talking about verse 48. The first part you need to understand is that Matthew 5 is broken down into seven different sections. Matthew 5 is broken down into seven different sections. Section number one is the B's. Verses 1 through 12 are the Beatitudes. The teaching Yeshua gave them that starts out with what some people call the Beatitudes. We're going to look at some of those verses and then come back to verse 48. Part number two of Matthew 5 is called the light. Those are verses 13 through 16. Part number two is verse 13 through 16, the light. When you lose the light, then you lose the perfection. Part number three, verse 17 through 19, is the perfect 100%. Part number three is verse 17 through 19, the perfect 100%. Part number four is verse 20 through 32, where Yeshua goes over points of the law. Verse 20 through 32 are points of the law. Part number five in chapter five of the book of Mattiyahu is verse 33 to 37. Vows are simple. Vows are simple. That's verse 33 to 37. Now part number six is verse 38 to 44, becoming a servant. Part number six is verse 38 to 44, becoming a servant. And finally, part number seven is verse 45 to 48. Now that you know all that, be perfect of at least try to. What? Yes, be perfect, for your Father in heaven is perfect. Okay, now we're going to break that down a little bit to try to get a handle on how far we've moved a boundary stone and why Islam is running amok around the globe, why homosexuality is taking over things, why fornication is rampant throughout the world, why adultery is, you know, pretty much everybody is doing it, okay? Now, it's because we don't follow this seven-point pattern that Yeshua told us in this teaching. Now, once again, and I have to say it because our website is doing a lot of work throughout the globe, and the Lord is leading many people to our website. So those that are new to Messianic Judaism, okay, that are listening to these teachings, the first point to remember is Yeshua, the Messiah, is a Jew. During his teachings, he's talking to Jewish people. He's talking to Jewish people, okay? So also remember that the Bible that you're holding in your hands or on your table or in your lap is a Jewish book from Genesis through to the book of Revelation. And you must look at this book with those eyes, with that mindset, that it is a Jewish book. It is not a Christian book. It is not a Gentile book. It is through and through a Jewish book. And it is the teachings, especially in the Brit Hadashah, must be understood with Jewish or Hebrew eyes. Okay? So let's take a look at part number one. Part number one, the bees. Let's go back to verse number six. Let's go back to verse number six. We're going to take it a little slower. Okay? Start off a little quick. Now we're going to take our time a little bit to understand how did we arrive where homosexuality is telling us that we must have single-sex bathrooms, that we must teach our children these disgusting things. How did we get that Islam is abducting Christian children all throughout the globe? How did we get where the Palestinians could lie with every breath they take And it starts with verse 6, with Yeshua's teaching. See, if we understand this, we understand the problem. Once you understand the problem, then you might be able to fix the problem. See, if you don't understand the problem, then you might go about trying to fix a problem, but not knowing what you're trying to fix. So let's look at verse 6. Matthew 5, verse 6. How blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Amen? So this part leads up to verse 48, where, you know, Yeshua said, be perfect, for your Father in heaven is perfect. Now, it starts with how blessed a person, and it's not specific to a man or a woman here, so how blessed are those people who hunger and thirst for what? Pizza. No. Who hunger and thirst for a root beer? No. What is he saying that you should hunger and thirst for? You should hunger and thirst for tzedakah, righteousness. Okay? If you hunger for this righteousness, then when somebody says, we don't need to do the Shabbat anymore, you go, no, thank you, because I'm hungering for perfection. I'm thirsting for what Yeshua gave me as righteousness. Now, when you go into Colossians and Ephesians and Galatians, see, some of these teachings are difficult to understand, says Peter, because Paul is writing to leadership of that baby messianic congregation who's dealing with certain issues. Okay? But if we hunger for righteousness, what would that hunger be? What is righteousness? How would I know what righteousness is? Okay? If I hunger for righteousness, then I wouldn't care that black lives matter. I wouldn't care what white lives matter. I wouldn't care what Filipino. I would care only for the Lord, and through that I care for all people. If I hunger for God's righteousness in my life, then I'm going to search for that righteousness. I'm going to ask. Now, look at the end of the sentence. The promise is there. Look at the promise. For they will be filled. If you hunger for tzedakah, righteousness, if you thirst for the living water of God's word, God's not going to say, you know, I'm going to keep him over there. I don't like that person. If you're hungering for God's ways, Yeshua is saying you will be filled. If we're searching for the government to help us, if we're searching for a president, a prime minister to fill us, then you will not be filled. Because God is the one who owns all things, and our Father, Avinu, is the one who's in charge of all things. So you will be blessed. The sentence starts out with, verse 6 starts out with a blessing. That you will be blessed if you hunger for what God wants to give. But if you hunger for what the world wants to give, then you're going to be still hungry. Then it's sort of like eating a snack. And you haven't eaten all day, and it's like, it's better not to have a snack. Because once you start eating, you're like, now your stomach's going, I want more, I want more. So it's fasting. You know, sometimes, like, you know, for Yom Kippur, we're supposed to fast. And the first year for many people is like they're dying, because all they're doing is focusing on, I can't eat or drink for Yom Kippur. But if you hunger for that time during Yom Kippur, I want more from God. This is His Day of Atonement. This is the day that I'm supposed to stop everything possible in my life, and I'm hungering for that knowledge. Then you're like, I'm not hungry at all. You know, you go through the 24 hours and you're like, that really wasn't so bad. It's after you come out of the fast and you take that first, you're like, yeah, my lips are a little dry. And you take that first sip of water and you're like, oh, you want more and more. So it's the same here that Yeshua starts off this teaching, this very powerful 7-point teaching. He starts it out here in the Beatitudes before he gets to anything else. Remember, he's talking to Jews. Now, also put yourself 2,000 years ago, what was going on in Israel? Now, Israel was under occupation once again. Between Malachi and Matthew, remember, there's a 400-year period where God didn't speak. He didn't say a word. He was angry with his people, except when the Maccabees recaptured the temple. And for a short period of time, they were able to keep that temple. But once again, they fell away. They started to mix paganism in with their worship of God. So now, Yeshua comes to the world as a man this time. And he's saying to these Jewish people, you're going to be blessed if what? If you hunger and thirst for righteousness. Now remember, they have the temple. Now remember, they're not on their own rule. They're under occupation from the Gentiles. They have the temple. They're able to sort of worship, but they don't have full rule. So Yeshua is saying, if you hunger and thirst to get back that boundary stone that was moved, if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, not the Talmud, but for righteousness, if you thirst for the living water from God, then what does he say is going to occur? Then you're going to be filled. God will not withhold anything from you. If you want to put the boundary stone back where it belongs. And that's what Beth Goyim is about. Not going to teach Talmud. Not going to teach Christian heresy. What I'm going to teach is to put that boundary stone back. I really don't even care that much about prophecy. Do I do it? Yes. But what I care most about is wanting to put back the boundary stone that our forefathers have moved. Because why? Look at verse 6 again. How blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Okay, before you get to verse 48, in striving for perfection, you must strive for this hunger. I want more knowledge of God. I'm thirsting for his living water. I am thirsting for following his ways. If you hunger for the truth of Jehovah, he's not going to withhold it from you. So if you say, some people say, well, we can't do the law, but I'm hungering to do what it says. He's not going to withhold it from you because he's a loving father. If you hunger for putting the boundary marker back where it belongs, you know what? What's this verse saying? He says, I'm going to help you put it back where it belongs. Then God will defend you. Then God will fight for you. God will bless us. God will make us safe. For Yeshua said here, what's it saying in this sentence? That if you hunger and thirst, your request will be fulfilled. But many people don't hunger and thirst for righteousness. They only hunger and thirst for a piece of righteousness. I can do this piece. He's not saying just do this piece. He's saying do more than this piece. Most people desire for certain parts of their fleshly requests. I'd like my wife to be like this. I'd like my husband to be like this. The people always say, change my husband. Change my wife. It's like, shut up. Please just shut up. How about change your heart that I would become a better servant to my wife? Change my heart that I would become a better wife to my husband. Okay? Change our heart to be a better servant of God. They're willing to, well, I can do the kosher thing. But they're not willing to really desire the Shabbat. They're not willing to do what the Word says. Then what happens? When you're not willing to do what the Word says, this leads to the coldness of heart. Where Yeshua says, in the end of days, bad things are going to happen because of increased distance from the Torah. And that's in Matthew 24:12. Because why? Because your heart becomes cold. But if you hunger and thirst for the righteousness of God's word, then what's going to happen? Your heart's not going to get cold. If you want something bad enough, God says, here, hunger and thirst for this, and I'll give you your heart's desire. Because your heart's desire is going to become his desire. Remember, we want to put the boundary marker back. Now let's look at verse 8. Let's look at the second part. How blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Amen? Now this is another beautiful sentence. How blessed are the pure in heart. What does pure in heart mean? Kadosh, pureness, holy, set aside. I want less of me and more of you. I want your pure word. I want your pure understanding. And then God says, then Yeshua says, for they will see God. If you're seeking a closer walk with the Lord, you must be pure in heart. Pure in heart. Pure in heart means that if it says, don't do this, then don't question how I shouldn't do it. Just don't do it. One of the rules that we have at this congregation, in this building, during Shabbat, there is no cellular phone usage. Why? Because in the Torah, in Leviticus, it talks about that the Lord walks amongst us. Okay? He dwells with us. And if this sanctuary is set aside for one purpose and one purpose alone, Shabbat is supposed to be sanctified. It's supposed to be a time for seeking the pureness of heart. See, when people, look at their cell phone, it's going to draw them to somewhere else. And it's like stepping in dog dew. Okay? It's like you're putting dog dew in the middle of the sanctuary. And God is walking in, and he wants to bless you, and you want God with his bare feet, because the place is supposed to be sanctified, to step in dog poo. Imagine God stepping in poop that you didn't pick up, and a little gushy between his toes. Okay? So here, look at verse 8. Why do I use that analogy? Because look at verse 8. How blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Pureness in heart is a desire for the things of God, especially on Shabbat. That's why it's a time where it's set aside until sundown tonight. On this Shabbat, it should be a time that one focus alone. I don't want to go to Facebook. I'm just looking at pictures. Well, where were you looking at those pictures? YouTube, Facebook? Do you have pictures, 100,000 pictures in your phone? What are you doing on there? Pure in heart. See, when you're pure in heart and you desire God and his ways, especially on the Sabbath, it means you want to put the ancient boundary marker back where it belongs. Okay? Because the day of rest of Shabbat is a day to learn how to put that boundary marker back. Okay? Pure in heart means keeping Shabbat on the day Yeshua did it. Okay? See, a lot of Christians like to say, well, I'm pure in heart. Okay? Well, you're worshiping on Sunday. How could you be pure in heart? Yeshua didn't do a Sunday. How could you be blessed and going to see the kingdom of God if you're not doing the Sabbath alone? Whoa, wait, let's slow that part down. How blessed are the pure in heart. How could you be pure in heart if you're doing a Sunday worship service as your main service? How could you be pure in heart? You will not see the kingdom of God because you've not pure in heart. You've broken the fourth commandment. Pure in heart means what? You follow Messiah's example. Pure in heart means you follow the Messiah's example. And if you think Paul is telling in the Messianic congregation in Colossae, the Colossian church, it doesn't matter what day you worship, then you are not pure in heart with God. You're pure in heart with yourself. If you think he's saying that, you are sadly, sadly mistaken. What is purity? What is purity? God tells you what purity is in the Torah. Purity is not moving the ancient boundary stones. For when we move the ancient boundary stone, we no longer love the Word of God. When we move the ancient boundary stone, we no longer love the Word of God. We no longer thirst for righteousness. When we move the boundary stone, then we are not pure in heart, for we are not seeking the kingdom of God. We are not seeking to please Yeshua. We are not seeking to follow the Ruach HaKodesh. We are not seeking to please Avinu, our Father. And then when we are not pure in heart, then we become cold in heart. And then you think it's okay to assassinate police officers. When you're not pure in heart, you think it's okay to assassinate somebody who's not trying to kill you. See, this is what's going on in the world. When you're not pure in heart, you think you can sell a 12-year-old girl in Islam for $12,500 on Facebook. When you're pure in heart, there is only one set of rules, God's rules, when you're pure in heart. Look at verse 8 again. How blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Amen? If you're going for that 100%, be holy, for your Father in heaven is holy. If you're going for the 100 on the test, yes, I'd like a 55 on my test, please. But if you're going for pureness, if you're going for thirst and hunger, then you're going for the 100. We all may fall short the glory of God, but trying. A parent loves when their kid tries. You're teaching your kid how to play baseball. And he's learning how to catch the ball, and he's done pretty well. And then, he goes to his first game, and he's in the outfield, and the other little kid hits the ball, and it's going out to your kid in the outfield, and he's in right field, and he's trying, he's catching it, and it hits his glove, and it falls out. You don't get mad at him. He tried, he just wasn't good at it yet. But the kid tries, and you show him, okay, use your hands, use both hands. Or whatever sport you like, soccer, how to kick the ball right, how to make it, do that curve thing, when you kick the ball, the curve to fool the goalie, all these things, trying. Sports are sometimes easy. Bowling, how do you get that ball to knock over those 12 pins would be even harder. No, maybe not, because then the space would be small and they'd fall over on each other. Okay, now, if we could do it for that, why can't we do it for our eternal souls? Look at verse 8. How blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Do you think doing 60% is okay? Do you really think by doing 60%, openly disobedient to 40% of the law, do you really think that God is going to be enough to Or do some sins weigh more than others? Absolutely. Okay, absolutely. There's different levels of sin. If you read the Torah in the 34 categories, there's different levels. There are majors and minors. So are you doing 40% of really bad stuff that will outweigh your 60 in a heartbeat? But Yeshua is saying here how blessed you are if you try to do the Torah. Now let's move to verse 10. Let's move to verse 10. How blessed are those who are persecuted because they pursue righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. Amen? You're going to be persecuted. If you stand for the Torah, especially in the disgusting world that has moved the boundary stone so far away from its original, Yeshua is promising you. And he's promising there 2,000 years ago, because every time he got into a discussion with the Pharisees and Sadducees, the Pirushim, and this, the Pirushim, when he got in arguments with them, discussions, you know, they tried to trick him up. Because why? If you're pursuing righteousness, people are not going to like it because they like their sin. You know, we were having this discussion at my home today about this shooting. And you know how we fix all these shootings? Every police officer in every police car has a camera rolling at all times. Because what, you know, the cameras start rolling for the bad people 5 minutes after something has already occurred. You know, like the shooting that started this. The shooting that started all this. If your beloved, the person you love, just got murdered by a cop, I don't think I would have the mind to get on my cell phone and post this video to Facebook. I really don't think I would be able to go, well, let me get my phone out now and log on to Facebook and videotape this and throw it up there. Something occurred, but the way we fix it is by having light on it. The way we fix it is having light on it. So you want to save all the police officer? You want to save all this trouble? Put a camera in the car. Put a camera on the shoulder of the cop. And then, here, let's look at the videotape. Doesn't lie. But then you, the police officers, and I have many friends that were police officers when I worked for the police department. Some guys that were good and some guys that were idiots. Okay? Because they're people. And when you're an amoral person, when you have not been taught the righteousness of God, and you're living in a society that does not teach the righteousness of God, when we try to tell the righteousness of God, look what happens. Look what happens in verse 10. How blessed are those who are persecuted because they pursue righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. That's what the leaders, what's been going on this whole week before the shooting, was many leaders that I've been reading their information, or hearing them, or their radio shows, or whatever, they're knowing that there's a problem, but they're Christian. They're looking at it through Gentile Roman glasses that are 2,000 years old. But Yeshua is telling us, he's telling those original Talmudim, those Jewish men, how blessed are those who are persecuted because they pursue righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. You're going to be persecuted, but the Lord says, I'll bless you if you thirst for and hunger for righteousness. If you want the purity of heart, you're going to run into bumps, but don't worry, I'll make it okay. If you thirst for really following the Lord, if you're a Gentile and you're like, there's something wrong with my church, well, it's a Sabbath, they're not doing it. If you go back to this, if you pursue righteousness, what's going to happen? How many people come to Beth Goyim now? There's like 100 to 120 people coming. And they were telling their pastors, well, what's about this Sabbath? And then they get kicked out because why? They were pursuing righteousness. Once you pursue righteousness, then you put the boundary stone back and people don't like it. That's what's going on around the globe. That's why the Lord is using Islam. Deuteronomy 28, verse 49 and 15. I'm going to raise these people up. Why? Because you move the boundary stone. You're not hungering and thirsting for righteousness. You don't want a pure heart. You don't like the boundary stone coming back. You want to do what you want to do. You want to fornicate. You want to go on the web. You want to look at the Facebook on Shabbat. You don't really want to be here on Shabbat. Well, then take what's coming to you. You know, just go party and be with the pagans. Enjoy it. But here, why is it so hard now? Because we're hungering and thirsting for righteousness. We want a pure heart, those of us who really love God. If you're willing to toss out family members from congregation, hungering and thirsting for righteousness, I know that if the Lord, because this goes back to Abraham in Genesis 18, when he said to the Lord, if there were 10, 50, 40, 30, 20, 10, I know and I believe in God's promises that if I hunger and thirst for his righteousness, if I hunger and thirst for a pure heart, I know I'm going to be persecuted by my fellow believers, fellow followers, fellow messianics. Like even the messianic community doesn't like me because I shine a light on their sin. How could you say that the Gentiles don't have to follow the Torah when there's one God of all creation? Shouldn't they be hungering for the same thing we're hungering for? Isn't Yeshua the same to the Jew and the Gentile? Isn't Jehovah the same to the Jew and the Gentile? But we get persecuted because why? Because we're pursuing righteousness. But what does Yeshua say? The kingdom of heaven is going to be yours. If you're persecuted for, people calling you legalistic. Oh, you're so legalistic. Thank you. I am very much so. I'm glad you noticed. Tell that to the police officer after he pulls you over and gives you a ticket for speeding. Well, you're being legalistic, officer. And what does he say? Have a nice day. I am, you know what I'm pursuing? I want to get a 100 on the test. Am I going to be perfect? No. But I'm going to try. I want to try to follow and walk in Yeshua. So what did he say? In Spanish, sígueme, follow me. Follow me. Follow me. He didn't say walk beside me. He said follow me. Yeshua doesn't say that you can't do it. He says you can. You can do it. If the purpose of the goal is to please the Father in heaven, this is what he starts the teaching off with. Go to verse 11 and 12. Anybody getting anything tonight? How blessed you are when people insult you and persecute you and tell all kinds of vicious lies about you because you follow me. Rejoice, be glad, because your reward in heaven is great. They persecuted the prophets before you in the same way. Amen? They persecuted the prophets. What are the three functions of a prophet? First function of a prophet. They functioned as preachers who expounded and interpreted Moshe's law to the nation. Let me say that again. What's the first order of business of a prophet? They functioned first as preachers who expanded and interpreted the Mosaic law, saying, this is how you got to do it. It was a duty to admonish, reprove, and denounce sin. Let me say that again. It was their duty to admonish, reprove, denounce sin. You know, we got lots of prophets in the church today. But do they admonish? Do they reprove? No, I see Brittany Denise. I see a bright future. I see, a big house. I see money. Yes, I see lots of money. I see prosperity. Yes, I do. What is the real prophet supposed to be doing? Admonishing. Brittany, what did you mess up today? What did you do? Reprove. Denounce sin. That's my job, is to shed light. Take the flashlight and go, hey, what are you doing over there? Hey, are you fornicating? Hey, are you adultery? That's the job. Second, what does a real prophet do? They function as predictors who would denounce coming judgments and deliverance of events relating to the Messiah. The prophets would announce judgment is coming. Why? Because you moved the boundary stone. Your hearts have become cold. And finally, a prophet functions as a watchman. Function as a watchman. Saying, there's something coming. Let me tell you something. There's something very horrible coming to the earth. Not just America. America is going to be chastised and broken and shattered into pieces by God himself. Because we were dedicated to God. Before they got off that boat, before they got off the Mayflower, before they got off the boat in Virginia, they dedicated this land to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And now there's hardly anybody who follows the commandment. Look at verse 11 and 12 again. How blessed you are when people insult you and persecute you and tell you all kinds of vicious lies about you because you follow me. Rejoice, be glad, because your reward in heaven is great. They persecuted the prophets before you in the same way. Amen? So people want to say you're legalistic. You say, thank you very much. You don't say, I'm not. No, I am. I'm extraordinarily legalistic because the boundary stone is supposed to be put back because be perfect for your Father in heaven is perfect. Well, we can't do that. Yeah, I know we're not going to be able to do it 100%, but I'm going to try to get an A on the exam. Oh, yes, I'd like to do, I want to get a D. Yes, yes, it matches my last name. That's what I'm shooting for, Brittany. I want to get a D. Please give me a 64. You know, I want to, that's what my son could in college. Yes, I want to take my calculus exam. I'm shooting for a D plus. That's what he really wants to know. That's what an employer wants to know. Yes, how did you do in calculus? Well, I got a D plus. How did you do in, you know, how did you, what part of the class were you in? Well, I held up the top part very well. You know, you want to be like my wife. What did she graduate in her school? Number 5. She got all sorts of scholarships to go to the college that she wanted. Very fine school for nursing. Because her father said, well, I can't have 2 kids in college. I can't pay your brothers. You know, I just can't do it. You know, I can't handle it. Okay? So what do you do? Look at verse 12. Rejoice, be glad, because your reward in heaven is great. They persecuted the prophets before you in the same way. Yeshua is saying, if you're going to be like them, rejoice. Rejoice in God's word. Now hold your place. Hold your place. Who's in heaven? Hold your place in Matthew 5. Turn to Luke 13. Luke 13. I'm going to do one verse. Hopefully you're learning something on the Shabbat teaching. Erev Shabbat. Luke 13, verse 28. Who is in heaven that we know of? Luke 13, verse 28. Luke 13, verse 28. Luke 13, verse 28. You will cry and grind your teeth when you see Abraham, Yitzhak, Yaakov, and all the prophets inside the kingdom of God, but yourselves thrown outside. So if you hunger and thirst for righteousness, you hunger and thirst for a pure heart, then you're going to be persecuted, but the prophets were persecuted too. But Yeshua, our Messiah, says that Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, the patriarchs, and they messed up. They were not perfect. Abraham, yeah, she's my sister. Yes, I'll sleep with Hagar. She's a fine-looking woman, an Egyptian woman. You know? She's 22. Yitzhak, he made some blunders. Yaakov, boy, Mr. Blunder himself. 2 wives, 2 concubines, potato head. Yo, I can't wait to meet Yaakov. It's like, dude, what were you thinking? What were you thinking? Yo, he's changed my wages these 20 years, all these times. You know, well, you know, mom tells you to put the hairy stuff on and put your brother's clothes on. Say, mom, I'm honoring you, but I'm not going to lie. You know, and let's just go tell dad and let the Lord work it out. But let's stay true to God. But you see that even if you're imperfect, you do get to heaven if you straighten up and fly right. Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov straightened up, and they finally, you know, God said, Abraham, I want you to bring your son, your only son, as an offering. Abraham didn't go, no! He finally got it right. All right, 3-day journey. Genesis 22. What happens in Bereshit 22? Offers up Yitzhak, right? Now go back to Matthew 5, please. Matthew 5. Five more minutes. I slowed it down a little too much. Matthew 5, verse 12. Rejoice, be glad, because your reward in heaven is great. They persecuted the prophets before you in the same way. Amen? Now with this knowledge, Yeshua moves into a passage they know very well. Now Yeshua speaks about being the light. The next part, be the light. After these Beatitudes, he talks about start being the light. Okay? Shining on light on all things. And people don't like when you shine a light. Okay? Then let's now look at verse 18. We know this verse very well. Okay? Part number 3 of Yeshua's teachings. Okay? Verse 18, Matthew 5, 18. Yes, indeed, I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not so much as a yod or a stroke will pass from the Torah, not until everything that must happen has happened. Amen? The boundary stone is still the boundary stone. Don't move it. Don't put it back where it belongs. If it's been moved in your life, put it back and just deal with the consequences. But God said, I'll help you. The prophets were right for telling the people that they've gotten cold. You know, the prophets, you know, Yirmiyahu, Yeshayahu, Isaiah, Jeremiah, you know, they told people you're doing wrong. And in Jeremiah 2, there's a real sad scripture where it says, you know, God says, why do you guys not like me? You know, what is so hard about these rules? They're good. You know, and we constantly fall away. But the Lord is saying, you know, Messiah, Yeshua is saying here, until heaven and earth pass away, keep that boundary stone where it belongs. Keep that boundary stone where it belongs. And finally, let's go to verse 48. Hopefully you've learned something today. And there's a whole study on the Beatitudes on our website. You go to messianicstudent.org. I think there's a 12-hour study at minimum on the Beatitudes. Matthew 5, verse 48. Therefore, be perfect just as your Father in heaven is perfect. Amen? Be perfect. Try to be perfect. Strive to finish the race. Strive to get an A on the test. Strive to hunger and thirst for righteousness. What does this perfection mean? It means that our God in heaven would never give us something that is bad. Let us strive today to know that only one life matters, and that's Yeshua's. It doesn't matter if you're black or white, yellow, Filipino, American, English, Indian, Mayan, Guatemalan, Costa Rican, Canadian, Mexican. It doesn't matter who you are. Those lives don't matter. The one life that does matter is Yeshua, our Messiah. Amen. And amen.
Shalom. This is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman. I would personally like to thank you for tuning in to the Remnant's Call each and every week. You can listen to the full message on our website, bethgoyim.org. If you have drawn closer to the King of Kings, learned more about Him today, we are blessed. If you are blessed by these messages, please consider a donation to our ministry. You can go to our website, bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. And click on the donate button. You do not have to have a PayPal account to donate. All you need is a debit card. Once again, thank you very much for listening to The Remnant's Call.
If you have not taken your first steps to be born again, just ask God's help. Remember, it's His loving grace that has come to find you. No one is worthy or able to reach God, but God can reach us, and He's reaching out to you now. Just open your heart and let Him in. His arms are open, and the blessing of salvation and eternal life are waiting for you. Don't let it wait any longer.
Shalom. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift his face and shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious unto you and give you his shalom.
Shalom. My name is Messianic Rabbi Andrew Dinnerman, and I invite you to come to visit our congregation. If you are in the tri-state area, come out and visit with us on Shabbat. We are a congregation of Jews and Gentiles, living as one in the Messiah Yeshua. BGMC is a place of true worship. The focus never wanders from the Hebraic roots of our faith. Beth Goyim is rooted in the Word of God from Bereshit through to the Book of Revelation. Messiah's strong words against man-made tradition are carefully recorded in Matthew 7. That is the reason we only follow the straight-up instructions found in Scripture. Truly, the way, the truth, and the life. If you're looking for a deeper walk with Adonai, come out for our Tuesday evening Bible study called Messianic Torah Time. Come, spend the day with us on any Shabbat. We start at 11 a.m. with the sound of the ancient Hebrew shofar. Next, we offer our King praise and worship in English, Hebrew, and Spanish. After worship, we review the headlines in the previous week's news from around the globe, especially news from the Holy Land Israel. We don't just list the news headlines as current events, but we comb through the scriptures, searching for clues to understand what they mean, and then to help pinpoint prophetically our current position on Adonai's clock. After digesting all that modern information, we leave the world behind as we journey with our Adonai deep into his eternal word. Not with just one or two scriptures, but usually seven or more scriptures. The spiritual nourishment and the richness of his kingdom become accessible to the ones who share this special time and seek them out. The day does not end there. Because Shabbat is so special to him, there is always so much more that our King desires to share. So instead of separating and leaving, we stay together as a family for potluck lunch and an afternoon study of our King's Word. We close the Shabbat together with the reading of the new week's parasha. That's the Torah portion. Even after those blessings, many of us just can't get enough. So the members bring prepared homemade foods to share while we all enjoy an uplifting movie together. If all that information is not quite enough, you can check out our website where you will find over 200 video teachings and biblical holy day studies. Under Messianic Torah Time, the Hebrew Roots button, you'll discover free studies on many, many different topics, including PowerPoint slide presentations. If Beth Goyim sounds like a place you'd love to visit, but you live outside the tri-state area, there is still a way to connect with us. We stream live on the internet on Tuesday, Thursday, and Shabbat. The website is www.bethgoyim.org. That's BETHGOYIM.org. Our phone number is 973-338-7800 or 978-2-YESHUA. That's 978, the number 2, Yeshua. Shalom.